we are finishing up our sermon series called Why? Making Sense of God's Will. Next Sunday, we will start a new series called Casting Our Vision. And we're going to be looking at our first Sunday in that series, which is next Sunday, we will be looking at the past and honoring the past. And so I would invite all of you who have been a part of this church to share your memories. Now, we may not get to everybody's, but I would invite you to start thinking about that, because this is going to, next week we're going to have a rather interactive sermon. So start thinking about that now so you can prepare for next Sunday. But today, as we wrap up our sermon series called Why? Making Sense of God's Will, we're going to look at why God's love prevails. And the scripture I've chosen for today comes from Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. After Moses, the Lord's servant, died, the Lord spoke to Joshua, Nun's son. He had been Moses' helper. "My servant Moses is dead. Now get ready to cross over the Jordan with this entire people to the land that I am going to give to the Israelites. I am giving you every place where you set foot, exactly as I promised Moses. Your territory will stretch from the desert and the Lebanon as far as the great Euphrates River, including all Hittite land, up to the Mediterranean Sea on the west. No one will be able to stand up against you during your lifetime. I will be with you in the same way I was with Moses. I won't desert you or leave you." During the last several weeks in this sermon series, we have explored some of the questions that we as Christians ask, especially in times of trial and tribulation, especially in times of difficulty and suffering. We've looked at why it seems as if God is not with us when we suffer. We've looked at why God seems to ignore our prayers. We've looked at why God's will seems to be so elusive. And in each case, we've realized that it's not God who is far away, but it is us who have pulled away from God. And today, as we finish up this series, which is based on Adam Hamilton's book, Why? Making Sense of God's Will, hopefully we've all come to realize that our old assumptions about how God works in the world just don't make sense anymore, and that they may not be correct, and that ultimately God does work all things for good for those who love God and who love Jesus. Well, in the fourth and final chapter of the book, Pastor Adam suggests three ways in which God shows God's love for us. So I'd like to finish this sermon series by taking a look at those three items. First, Pastor Hamilton suggests that God's presence is always with us, even in the face of tragedy. We know this, but sometimes it's hard for us to remember. For instance, when we get a bad medical report from the doctor, or when we're in a tragic accident and we are seriously injured, or when we discover that our investments have taken a dive, it's hard for us to remember that even in the tragedy, that God is with us. And you know, frankly, when those things happen, we become fearful, don't we? We're afraid because we don't know what the future will hold. When we get that bad medical report, we don't know what's going to happen. When we have that bad accident, we are fearful. And when our investments take a dive, we don't know what the future will hold. And so naturally, we become scared. Often we will pray to God for a miracle, but we now know that that's not always the way that God works, is it? We pray to God to somehow make that diagnosis go away. Or we pray to God to somehow restore the money that was in our bank accounts. Or we pray to God to turn back the hands of time so we can avoid that intersection where the accident occurred. But that's not the way God works. We know that in our rational parts of our brain, we know that. But we ask anyway, hoping that God will come through. And what we forget is that God has already come through. Through Scripture, God has promised us that God will always be with us, no matter what. We know that because in our mind's eye, we see the two sets of footprints in the sand. And we also know that God carries us through those difficult times, because that's when we see the single set of footprints instead. God helps us through those deepest, darkest moments. And we know that because we read about it in Scripture. In fact, there are so many instances in the Bible where God tells God's people that they're not alone. People like Noah and Abraham in the Old Testament, and people in the New Testament like Jesus and Paul. In fact, the entire biblical narrative is the story of God's people and how they have walked with God even when they didn't know it. Well, the passage that I selected for today's reading from Joshua is just one of those passages. You know, we kind of skip over Joshua, don't we? We focus a lot on Moses, but when it comes to Joshua, we kind of go, oh yeah, he's the guy that kind of led them over the river, right? But he was really a very important part of the biblical narrative because he was the one that led the people over the River Jordan. He was the one who led God's armies into the region, the promised land. It was Joshua who was named by God to lead the people and to fight the battle at Jericho, where the walls came a-tumbling down. It was Joshua who took control of the kingdom of Ai. And it was Joshua who defeated the Hittites, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Perizzites, and the Jebusites. Bet you didn't think I could get through that list, right? God was with him every step of the way. God promised Joshua from the very beginning that God would be with him through all of those battles. And Joshua placed his faith in God, and therefore he was not afraid. So when we have faith that God will always be with us, we too can push our fears aside. Faith is our response to the problem of fear. And it got me to wondering, is that perhaps the reason why this church was called Faith United Methodist? When we come to trust that God is with us, it gives us the peace of mind to go on. It gives us the strength to do the work that God has called us to do. Well, the second way that Pastor Adam suggests that God shows God's love for us is in the way that God works through us to answer people's prayers. Now, we talked a lot about this in the second week of the series, so I won't belabor the point, but when we remember that God nudges us, and when we pay attention to those nudges, God can do marvelous things through us, and God will intervene because we become God's vehicle. I experienced this just this past week. On Thursday morning, I had promised a church member who was in the hospital that I would come to her room there at the hospital and I would bring her Holy Communion. Well, as I got ready to leave the house, I realized that I did not have any grape juice. And our home here is not very far away, so at first I thought, well, I'll just run by the church and I'll pick up some grape juice, put it in my little container, and off I'll go. Well, I literally turned my car in the direction of the church, and then I heard in my head, I bet there's a convenience store on the way. because the hospital I was going to was south of my home, and the church, of course, is north. So it was really out of my way to come to the church a little bit. So in my head, I thought, well, there must be a convenience store that will have grape juice, so I'll just turn around and head the other way. Well, I turned onto Glendale Avenue, where indeed there was a 7-Eleven, and as I parked my car and got out, there off to the side was a woman leaning on a shopping cart. It was obvious that she was homeless. She was dirty. She was disheveled. But more than that, she was very, very sad. And so as I walked into the 7-Eleven, of course I had on my mind I need to get grape juice. I walked into the 7-Eleven and I smiled at her and I went inside. So I went to the refrigerator section to get my grape juice, and guess what? They didn't have any grape juice. And as I walked outside, I realized that God, without me even knowing it, had nudged me to go to that 7-Eleven. So I walked over to the woman. And I asked her her name. Her name is Pam. She told me that she'd been on the street since May. She told me that she had no hope. I asked her if she had eaten, and she said it had been several days. And so I gave her some money, and I suggested that she get something to eat. And then I asked her if she was a Christian, and she said yes. And I asked her if I could pray for her. Of course, I would have prayed for her whether she was a Christian or not. But I prayed. I took hold of her hands. And we prayed together. And as we were praying together, I felt a drop hit my hand. And I knew that she was crying. I asked God to give her the strength to make through another day. I asked God to help her do whatever she needed to do to get out of homelessness. But more than that, I asked God to continue to walk this journey with her, this very, very difficult journey. And as I finished the prayer, we once again looked at each other, and she wouldn't let go of my hand. It was as if I was her lifeline to God. God used me that day to do God's work, to remind this woman named Pam that God was with her and that God loves her no matter what. The third way that Pastor Adam suggests that God shows God's love for us is something that you may not have thought of before, but it's really kind of an interesting concept. What he says is that God bends evil and suffering to do God's will. Now, I know what you're probably thinking. How in the world can God do that? But when we look back on history, and we look back on some of the awful things that have happened, we can see where God has taken evil and suffering and made it good. God has turned something upside down and brought good out of tragedy. The assassination of Martin Luther King in 1968 gave impetus to the civil rights movement and led to the Voting Rights Act that was passed not long after that, which guarantees the right of all American citizens the right to vote. The death of Hector Peterson, a young boy who was shot in 1976 during the Soweto riots in South Africa. Experts believe that that was the tipping point that led towards the abolishment of that awful system of apartheid in that country. And in the wake of September 11th, 2001, people in this country rushed to the aid of the victims and their families. We saw a rise in nationalism that we had not seen for a long time. And we also saw an increase in people rededicating themselves to God. Some of these changes were lasting. Others, not so much. But God took those tragic events and transformed them into something good. But you know, the ultimate example of this is Jesus' death and resurrection. Jesus died a horrible, horrible death. He was tortured before he was placed on that cross. But ultimately, God prevailed. The resurrection of Jesus 3 days later was a shout from God. It was as if God was saying, "No, no more." And Jesus was alive. The resurrection was God's ultimate way of demonstrating God's love for us by showing us in no uncertain terms that the worst thing will never be the last. The worst thing will never be the last. Or as we heard the Apostle Paul write to the church in Rome, nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing. Neither death nor life, nor angels, nor prince, nor rulers, not present things or future things, not power, height, or depth. Nothing keeps us from the love of God because, and we said it in the call to worship, God's steadfast love lasts forever. Say it with me. God's steadfast love lasts forever. Amen. Will you join?